Hi, I'm Phil Constantine. On this episode of Travels with Phil, we're going to Lehman Caves in the Great Basin National Park. Well, I'm in San Diego, so let's give you an idea of where this is located. It's in Nevada, just a rock's throw almost from Utah, not too far from Baker and a few other spots out there. This is a view from the parking lot looking down, and a side view here from the National Park Service. That's the map on the left, the map on the right, and you'll see the map on the right every once in a while in this tour. And this is also a 3D kind of image showing you the way. Well, it used to be people came down through a natural entrance and it was dark. You had to have lamps or lanterns to get into it. And it was, you know, real exploring. Well, now they've got a big lighting and a special entrance there, and this is the spot where you come in. So let's take a look inside. I'm going to speed it up, slow it down in a few spots here, but basically give you a virtual tour of almost the entire place that you can take or get to on some of the tours here. And there are some bats in the cave, by the way. So taking a look around, these are some of the hallways you go through. Now, the floors are concrete, and they've had concrete in there since about, I guess, about the 1950s through most of it. But they do changes every once in a while. And you'll see some spots that are dark, and this is a spot where you might see the town's big-eared bat. And by the way, if you go through there, they are very conscious about the white nose syndrome problem among bats, so they may check your shoes and ask you've taken your shoes else into other caves. This is where the natural entrance used to come down, and you can't see up in there. They don't have lights up in there. You can see sort of a railing up there. That was where you used to be able to come into the cave system, and then you would enter this passage. All this passage was worked out a little bit more so people can get through. Now, in some spaces, it is fairly narrow. You do have to duck down a couple of times as you travel through, turn sideways in a couple of spots, but for all practical purposes, except for people that are in wheelchairs, it's pretty well accessible for almost anybody that has a reasonable ability to walk. And well, you're going to see all kinds of stuff here. Sometimes this is called stalactites, stalagmites, speleothopes. They're also called flowstone, travertine, all kinds of names for this. But basically what happened was most of this was a marble area. Waters came up when it was still underground and sort of, ate away at the marble and the special content in the water itself caused this to happen. And this happened over many, many years. They think they may be as old as 2 million years old. And here you see stalactites, the C from ceiling, T for tight, hanging to the ceiling, and stalagmites, G for the ground, and M for you might trip over one because they're coming up from the ground. And then when these drippings connect all the way from the ceiling to the floor, they're called a column. And what happens is the liquid will drip down from the ceiling and slowly but surely build up, almost like tartar on your teeth. And if it gets all the way down to the ground, it makes a column. If it only extends from the ceiling a little ways, stalactite. And if it starts building up from the ground because of the drip, it just, you know, building up, then it's called a stalagmite. And you can see lots and lots of unusual forms out there. Now, it may take as long as 100 years for some of these to grow an inch. And you are not supposed to touch anything inside the caves because once a human touches it, the oil from your skin can cause the growth patterns to stop completely. So you have to be very, very careful and be conscientious and pay attention to what the rangers do. You cannot go through here just on your own. They do have tours specifically through here, and that's the only way you can access them now, with some rare exceptions. And the tours are not free. They charge. Now, this is an example. One of these little pieces here broke off, and in that area, they figured it might grow maybe 4 inches in 100 years, but in other spots, much less than that. You see buildup here from the ground. Now, some places they call them music rooms because they look like pipe organs. Other places they call the tom-tom room. There's all kinds of critters in here. This is a pseudo-scorpion. It has no stinger on the rear. The millipede there. And here's the harvestman, an unusual type of spider. Many of these are only indigenous to the local areas. Now, they do have guardrails in a few spots. You go up and down a little bit. 260 some odd feet is the deepest that it goes from the original surface. Draperies, I like to call them bacon. They really do look like bacon when you see them from the side. And these are ones that just sort of build up and form a little ridge on the side as they come down in a little band. And as you come along, you'll see other ones here. This is sometimes called flowstone. Some people call this the music room because it looks like pipe organs. You'll see different names for different things. Sometimes a name will catch on. Sometimes a name will be popular for a while and then go out of popularity and then come back again, go back and forth. Even the peak around here was once called Jeff Davis Peak. It's now called Wheeler Peak. And the caves are named after Absalom Lehman. Now, he was the first European American to discover the caves, they think. And sometime around 1885, they think. They're not absolutely sure what's going on. But, you know, the Park Service has all kinds of records. You can look in the description field below and you'll be able to see some very good articles written on it. And that part of the history, they're not so sure about. The indigenous folks like the Shoshones, they think have been coming into the cave, at least the entrance parts, for maybe as long as 10 to 12,000 years. Now, this is called the Panama Canal. This is a section where the natural path to get to the next part of the cave system was very, very narrow. So they came in and actually dug this out. The WPA, CCC did some work in the 1930s. Some work it may have been done earlier than that in the 1920s. And so this part actually was done to bypass this spot. And the spot was so narrow, they called it Fat Man's Misery because you had to lay down and crawl to get through it. And you'll see it here in just a second as we come around the corner. But sometimes they do that. And other places, they actually close down sections because there's been rock falls. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a bit. So right around the right, to your right here, you'll see where the old path entrance came through. And in fact, turn the lights on here and you'll see it. And there they go. All right. And that was called the Fat Man's Misery Passage. There it is right there. And this is what it would have looked like had you come through in the old days when you crawled through. And you imagine people, you know, carrying their lanterns and trying to crawl through, do this. Now, I've been spelunking caving since the 70s, I guess. And I don't like crawling through there. I've got busted up knees. But some folks cannot stand it. Claustrophobic. And so that's why most of the caves are, you can do standing up, and that makes it easier for just the general population. But when they came through on the original tours, people could pay 50 cents to come in. They let them use their carbides or their lamps, candles, and burn their initials into the ceiling, the soot coming off of whatever it was that was making the light. And so there are sections of these. Some of these go back again to the 1885s, and you can see the map up there. This tells you, generally speaking, what area you're in. Now, when the National Park Service took over, about 86, I think it was, they tried to get rid of some of these things, and they found out that just the trying to clean them off was causing more damage or looked worse than they originally were. So, and in some cases, they're old enough to be considered a historical thing. So they stopped trying to clean them off, but you can see some discoloration if you go through there yourselves. And you see here, there's all kinds of stuff. There were some bubbles that came through there. There was carbonation type of action that was coming from the water. Acids were working at stuff, and the water levels would rise and lower and rise and lower. It would cause different patterns into the way the rocks form. Now, this section right here is, it's called a cypress swamp, and it does look like that. So some of these names are pretty good in their descriptions of what's going on. Now, some cases the water will rise, some cases the waters will lower. There's another spot not too far from here called the lake room. And the temperatures are usually about 10 to 14 degrees Celsius, centigrade if you prefer. And so it stays pretty cool down here. The temperature for the air is usually in the 50 to 60 range, give or take a little bit. So it's not exceptionally cold, but it's not warm either if you plan on visiting. So it's relatively comfortable if you have long sleeves on. And this is called the Grand Palace. And again, a lot of these names sometimes change, but this is generally speaking what you will see on the brochures. And there is a lot of this cave that is not open to the general public. And as you can see here, sometimes it'll turn and you'll see some things in the distance. And, you know, you can tell that, you know, there's more out there. Well, in some cases, there's lots more out there, but just the access to it is hard. Or in the talus room, which is at the very end of this, you can't get in there anymore because there was a rock fall that caused some major damage. And so they decided discretion being the better part of valor. Now, these right here, these are called shields. And how they operate, it's a matter of debate. The one on the left there is called the parachute shield, and that's sort of the iconic image for Lehman Cave. And shields, they're pretty rare. There's been, I think, about 500 of them discovered in one place or another inside Lehman Caves. And that's very unusual. They're very, very rare out there. There's things that you will see in different caves that are pretty much only happen in that area. If you look at my video about Wind Cave up in the South Dakota, you'll notice there's some latticework kind of stuff up there that's fairly unusual. And so you can see different spots out here. Now, they do have a concrete flooring, again, as I said earlier. And, well, you know, they estimate 30 to 40,000 visitors a year. Now, this is called a cupola, and this is where the you know, the water with the chemicals in it will seek the highest spot, and it starts to eat away and form a little dome inside. Some of them a couple inches, some of them a couple of feet. So it's interesting stuff. Again, there's the map there showing you basically where you're at. And these things, you know, take a long, 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 long time to develop. They're very fragile. When they first opened the cave, the people that were coming through would take samples, take souvenirs. Well, you can't do that anymore. But you can find these kinds of things in different places. Travertine is another example of it. Now, this is called the Sunken Garden. Now, this is the part that's deepest below the surface of the mountain itself. And people had been on the mountain for probably a couple of decades, at least European Americans had been for a couple of decades and never seen the cave entrance. And they were all around it. This right here, you can see some standing water and a little symbol over there for cave water. Yes, indeed, there is. And as you look around, the lights are not always on like this. They will turn lights on as they come through. But this is a special lighting to get this video through here so you can see it all lit up. Now, this is the end of it. This is the Royal Gorge, and this takes you back into the talus room. And that's actually a much bigger section than a lot of the rooms or hallways, the vaulted areas that you've seen so far. But again, there was a rock fall through there, and they're concerned about the safety of it. So they no longer allow the general public back in that area there. Sometimes they give special permits to experienced cavers to go into certain areas of different ones. There's more than one cave in this general vicinity, but this is by and far the biggest one. All right, so this is as far as you can go on the end of the trail. Then so they turn around and bring you back. And this is called the lodge room. They used to have dances in this area here, meetings, all kinds of stuff down there. In fact, you'll see a picture here in a couple of seconds. They filmed part of a science fiction movie in here to make it look, you know, alien. So there's been concerns about doing these kinds of things because of the long-term damage, the moisture coming out from people's breath. The material and the exhaled oxygen and carbon dioxide and those kinds of contents. So they're a little concerned about having big meetings down here. Now, this stretch right here, what's that look like to you? Well, they call it the giant's ear, a big ear on the side there. And so some folks do have creative ideas and imagination, which is sort of nice. And if you go through, yes, definitely the tour guides will tell you about that. So they blasted out, they made an area to come in, and because it was so narrow, they said, well, we can't have people going, bumping into each other as they're going in and going out. So they made a separate exit. And because of that, they did have to do a little bit of blasting to make it big enough for the average person to get through. And so that's what you see in this section right here. You can see where, you know, the walls are, or at least, you know, up to about elbow height, hip height, have been blasted out. Now, every cave I've ever been in that has commercial tours, they always turn out the lights. So you can see what it's like without the lights being on. And so I'm going to do that right here. And again, just remember, animals do live here, critters, insects, and their natural habitat is darkness. So they try to keep it dark unless people are going through there. And that's what it would look like if you were trying to come in. Now, I've gone into some undeveloped caves, and it's a little spooky. And, you know, in some cases, folks don't like to go into caves because they're claustrophobic. And so that's understandable, but they did have to do some digging out here. And so this will take you to the long, long tunnel to get out. And it's an interesting tour. The long tours run about an hour and a half. They have shorter tours right now in 2021. They have limited tours because of the COVID situation. But you do have to pay for them, and the prices vary. And I went through there a few years back with my friend Haylee and her children, Shandine and Tristan, and that was us there. So this has been Lehman Caves in the Great Basin National Park. Thank you very much for watching this video. Please feel free to make comments below as long as the language is family friendly. And if you like this video, please click on the thumbs up button below. You can also subscribe to my YouTube channel by clicking on the circle with my picture in it in the lower right hand corner of the video. The arrow is pointing at it now. And once you have subscribed, you can be notified of when I have a new video posted by clicking on the bell icon in the description field below the video. Thanks again for watching.